The goal of this lecture video is to focus on the short-term regulation for how we regulate our mean arterial pressure, our MAP. So we will be discussing baroreceptors. So a quick recap, baroreceptors are located in the carotid sinuses and in the aortic arch. These are stretch receptors. They're a type of mechanical receptor that detects stretch. And when they detect stretch, they send action potentials to the cardiovascular control center. Now, what's going to be altered depending upon the stretch is the frequency of the action potentials that get sent to the cardiovascular control center. So the frequency here is dependent upon how much stretch. A lot of stretch, a high frequency of action potentials. Very little stretch, a low frequency of action potentials. Or a middle amount of stretch, then a middle amount of frequency of action potentials being sent to the cardiovascular control center. So let's look and get some more specifics here. So when we look at this diagram is showing your arterial pressure here on the y-axis in association with the baroreceptor response. So the action potentials that the baroreceptors are capable of generating, remember these action potentials get sent to the cardiovascular control center in the medulla. So let's look at a normal map. When our mean arterial pressure is normal, there is some pressure in the carotids and in the aorta. And so what this means is that the baroreceptors detect some stretch because there is some pressure in the blood that's passing through these vessels. So as the blood passes through and it's under a certain amount of pressure between 70 and 110, the baroreceptors then, by detecting some stretch, generate this particular frequency of action potentials. And that frequency of action potentials goes off to the cardiovascular control center, and then that gets interpreted as normal MAP. So if your MAP is normal, there's no need for the cardiovascular control center to respond. Now, there are other things that could cause our MAP to be elevated or lower. So maybe we're exercising, for example, and your MAP increases. So here we are in the middle part of our diagram now where we have an increased MAP. And so here you could see that your pressure is increased above normal, normal being the upper normal being the dotted line. So we have now more stretch than normal. So the baroreceptors are detecting more stretch in the wall of the carotids and the aortic artery than normal. So if there's more stretch, that means that the baroreceptors are going to send a higher frequency of action potentials to the cardiovascular control center. And then from there, the cardiovascular control center will respond. And I'll show you what that response is here on the next couple of slides. Now, if we have a low MAP, there's less stretch that's detected by the baroreceptors. So if there's less stretch detected by the baroreceptors, the baroreceptors are going to send a lower frequency of action potentials to the cardiovascular control center. From there, then, the cardiovascular control center can decide on a response. So let's take a look at what these responses are. All right, so what this slide does is it brings back a couple of things that you guys have seen before so far. One of those is that it illustrates to you very nicely the parasympathetic innervation to the heart. Remember, the heart is innervated by the parasympathetic fibers at the SA and the AV node. And it also demonstrates how the sympathetic nervous system innervates the heart. Remember, again, SA, AV, and ventricular myocardium. It also reminds us that the sympathetic nervous system or the sympathetic fibers innervate the smooth muscle of the arterioles as well as the smooth muscle of the veins. If you're having a parasympathetic response and that message is being sent to the heart, well, we know the heart rate's gonna go down. Please be sure to review why the heart rate goes down. So backtrack, right? Think about the frequency of pacemaker potentials and why that frequency changes. What channels are augmented? What channels are delayed and so forth? Because if your heart rate goes down, we know your cardiac output will go down. Cardiac output goes down, that means there's less blood leaving the heart per minute, so your blood pressure goes down. If you're having a sympathetic response, we know that the sympathetic fibers innervate the heart, and we know the effect on heart rate. Again, backtrack and tell me about the frequency of the pacemakers, what channels are augmented, what channels are delayed. Tell me how the force of contraction goes up, what four mechanisms are in place that increase the force of contraction, which therefore increases your stroke volume. So you put these two things together, we get an increased cardiac output and an increased blood pressure. Sympathetic stimulation to the arterioles, as you already know, causes vasoconstriction. Vasoconstriction increases your total peripheral resistance, and if you increase resistance, your blood pressure goes up. When the sympathetic fibers innervate the nerves, innervate the veins, that also causes vasoconstriction. But remember, the veins are what are delivering blood to the heart. So that increases your venous return because you're squeezing on the vein, so whatever's in it gets pushed into the heart. If you increase venous return, this increases your end diastolic volume, which will increase your stroke volume. Stroke volume then, if it increases, cardiac output goes up, and once again, blood pressure will go up. That's a nice review of everything, but what exactly is going on here? Let's look at an example where you have a situation where mean arterial pressure has lowered. So maybe you have a patient who hemorrhaged, for example. So when they hemorrhaged, they lost a lot of blood, their blood pressure dropped. So let's look at the response, the body's response to a drop in blood pressure. Remember what our goal needs to be. The goal needs to be to increase MAP. So how are we going to increase MAP? So let's begin with a low MAP. Because you have a low mean arterial pressure, is there enough stretch in your baroreceptors compared to normal? Are the baroreceptors stretching more than normal or less than normal? The correct answer is there's not enough stretch, right? There's not enough stretch detected by the baroreceptors because of the low pressure. And so because there's not enough stretch detected by the baroreceptors, they send a low frequency of action potentials to the cardiovascular control center. I crossed off central nervous system and wrote in cardiovascular control center for you just so that you're realizing we need to be much more specific here, right? So it's not incorrect to say CNS, but it's more accurate and more specific to say cardiovascular control center. So now, when the cardiovascular control center receives a low frequency, that's going to cause a decrease in parasympathetic activity and an increase in sympathetic activity. So what does the sympathetic activity do? Well, we know the sympathetic nervous system innervates the SA and the AV node, and that increases the action potential frequency. Remember, specifically, it increases the frequency of the pacemakers. Go back again and review. What channels are augmented? Which channels are delayed? Why is it that heart rate goes up? Now, sympathetic activity is also, the nerves are also going to innervate the ventricular myocardium, which increases contractility. What are the four ways that contractility is increased? Be sure to review that, because if we increase contractility, that increases stroke volume. So be sure to review the mechanism. Now, sympathetic nervous system also innervates the veins. So this is the smooth muscle of the veins. And when that happens, that increases venomotor tone because it causes the veins to vasoconstrict. And if they vasoconstrict, that decreases compliance. So let's just define compliance up here for you. So compliance is the ability of a blood vessel to stretch as pressure inside of it increases. So if I'm vasoconstricting a vein, so imagine constricting it, and if I'm constricting it, its ability to stretch goes down, right? Because there's muscles contracting, causing it to constrict. Compliance goes down. And that means your venous pressure goes up. That will increase your venous return, which will then increase your end diastolic volume, which increases your stroke volume, which increases your MAP. Remember, that was our end goal. Now, the sympathetic nervous system also innervates the arterioles. We know that increased sympathetic activity causes vasoconstriction of the arterioles, which increases total peripheral resistance, which increases MAP. Once MAP returns to normal, the system will shut off via negative feedback. What I suggest to you is that you make a flow chart. This one was for a situation where MAP was low. You should make one for where MAP is too high, it's elevated. Lastly then, we've already talked about when your blood pressure falls below normal. We've already talked about the bottom portion of this diagram, so we can divide this diagram in half. The top portion is where we have a situation where your MAP is too elevated. If your blood pressure is too high, what's the goal? The goal is to lower MAP. So if your blood pressure is too high, is there a lot of stretch detected by baroreceptors or very little? Hopefully you said there's a lot of stretch. More stretch than normal that's detected by the baroreceptors. And if there's more stretch detected, then that means it's going to increase the rate of action potentials being sent to the cardiovascular control center. Don't worry about these receptor potentials. Those are just types of graded potentials that the baroreceptors generate, and we won't worry about those. It's just important to understand that because there's more stretch detected by the baroreceptors, they increase the frequency of action potential sent to the cardiovascular control center. All right, so then in this case, we're going to decrease sympathetic activity. We're going to increase parasympathetic activity. So parasympathetic activity, we know heart rate's going to come down. Okay, we know stroke volume's going to go down. And we're going to have arterial or in venous vasodilation because there's less sympathetic innervation. Remember, the parasympathetic nervous system does not innervate veins or arterioles. Vasodilation is because you have less sympathetic stimulation, so it vasodilates now. So in all, that's going to decrease your cardiac output and decrease your total peripheral resistance, and therefore your blood pressure will return to normal. The system shuts off via negative feedback. Be sure to go through and decide which of these, decreased heart rate, decreased stroke volume, arterial or venous vasodilation, which of those give rise to lower cardiac output, which of them give rise to lower TPR. And that way you're getting the very specifics that you need. And to do that, if you made a flow chart like the previous slide, that would help you tremendously. Add in the detail here that's missing.